Do you appreciate debuggers?
Very much so. I mean, a debugger is how you get a view into a system that's too complicated to understand. I mean, anybody that thinks just read the code and think about it, that's an insane statement.
This was John Carmack, considered by many as the best developer of all times. He's the creator of games like Commander Keen, Wolfenstein 3D, Doom, Quake, and their sequels. But this is for another video. The full podcast with Lex Friedman is linked below, highly recommended. I recently made a video with the big claim that Neovim is an IDE, despite many claim otherwise. A big part of having a real integrated development environment is being able to run a debugger. Today, I want to get into that, how Neovim not only provides the environment using DAP, but with a few other plugins and a super quick setup, you can have your own debugger running and helping with your daily tasks right within Neovim. Before getting into configurations and shortcuts, let me showcase what you can do with everything installed and integrated into Neovim. I'm gonna pick one of my known open source projects and run it there. So opening main.go, I can run leader.dt to toggle the debugger. What you actually see is DAP UI, and that's a set of windows that help us with the debugging process. We'll get into each in a little bit. What I'm going to do now is set a breakpoint. You can see the B on the left marking that. And once I have that, I can trigger the start of the debugger process. I choose how to run it. It marks in green at the breakpoint where I can debug the variables, see what's going on in the different windows, and proceed either by continuing to the next breakpoint, stepping into the one that I'm looking at, stepping over, stepping out, everything you have in a normal debugger, you can go and do right here. To improve the usage a little bit, let's put a logical breakpoint, not on the switch, but on the actual place that leads to this classify function, so we can read some of the variables. So I'm going to one of the references using my LSP, and then I'm setting the breakpoint here where fatbot_update.classify is being actually called. Now let's run the debugger and see how that affects the process. As you can see, you can set a breakpoint not only with shortcuts, but it's already pre-built into Neovim commands that you can reach out from your command line. Let's start the debugger with one, which is a standard debugging process, and I can see the log on the window on the bottom. And I now clicked on Telegram because this is a Telegram bot, and you can see that the breakpoint has been triggered. And now I can step into the breakpoint and actually view where it's going. I can keep stepping into either using a shortcut or the command line like I'm doing here. Let's do a little terminology break just to explain the different settings of DAP, like stepping over, stepping out, stepping in. So consider the following code with the current instruction pointer. The line that will be executed next is indicated by an arrow, and at the FX line in G function. This process was initiated below by calling the function G with 2 as input. If you were to step into at that point, you'll move the print line command in the F function, stepping into the function call. If you were to step over at that point, you'll move to the F1 line in the G function, stepping over the function call. Another useful feature of debuggers is stepping out or step return. In that case, a step return will basically run you through the current function until you go back up one level. In other words, it'll step through fx and f1 and then back out, calling the function, end up at g(3) and main. A nice thing here is that I have a few different consoles. One of them is the variables, and I can query the fatbot update, for example, and expand sub variables, read the entire set of internals, whether that's a structure or just a standard variable. I can read them and understand what's going on right there in the breakpoint. So I don't have to stop and do all those standard prints we're used to in a normal debugging process. That's the power of a debugger. As you can see, when I continue, there's a notification popping up from Telegram actually telling me that the process has ended, and I got the response back to it. Now, on the windows to the left, I can see different things. One of them are a list of the breakpoints. I can see the local variables that are relevant to the same point, and we'll touch a little bit on that later, both on how I can view them conveniently and how I can use them. And I have a REPL console on the top left, which we've touched earlier, with different expressions that I can not only view and read variables, but actually set things while I debug to help me understand what's going on with the application right at this point in time. We'll get back to the process. Let's go a little bit and query the configuration and how it's all being done pretty quickly and pretty easily. I'm opening init.lua for Neovim, and as you can see, I have three main plugins here. One of them is the DAP UI, which are the set of windows that you've seen, and that requires Nvim DAP, which is the base for everything that we've seen earlier. Then I have Nvim DAP virtual text, which I'll show you what it does, but basically show you the variables that are set currently in the breakpoint right next to where we are in the code. It'll become more clear later. And lastly, I have a specific plugin for Go that sets the DAP adapter for the Go language. And then a few shortcuts, pretty easy. One of them is toggling the UI. The second is setting a breakpoint. Next is continue to start a process and jump to the next breakpoint. And lastly, something that I use quite often, which is resetting the style of the windows because they can change over time. Maybe I've closed a few, maybe I've zoomed into one of the windows and I want to reset the UI. So that helps. So to keep it short and simple, just Packer install or whatever other plugin manager you're using and make sure that everything's there ready to go. I'm going to open, for the sake of example, main test, which is a standalone test that I've written specifically for the sample here and the example. And I'm going to add another print to the test just so it's easy to see what we're doing and set breakpoints that are easily explicable. By the way, if you've noticed, when I saved Go format ran and updated my imports, so that's kind of cool. You can see it back in my Golang video that I'll show up here. In any case, we have everything set. Let's start by toggling the UI and then setting some breakpoints where I'm printing and also in the test itself where if A is smaller than B. And we'll see why I did that in a second. I'm gonna pick 5, which is debugging a specific test here, just so we can debug that test and not run the entire application. And as soon as I start, the breakpoint hits and you can see the green line. Now, a cool thing about that, if you'll notice, I see A equals 2 and B equals minus 2, and that's my text plugin that I told you about earlier. To the left on the top, I can see the REPL console where I can also print all the variables and set additional expressions. And I can see local variables down below on the left that helps me understand what's going on wherever I'm going. If I continue to the next breakpoint or step into it, you can see the next line is marked. And now I have additional set of variables. Obviously, I cannot see what A and B are because they're no longer relevant. I can query other variables or query other things that are going on, for example, like T for testing. That's just helpful in that case. Last breakpoint is the print line. And since my test is good and valid, I can go on and it prints some good. And the test passes. I can set and delete breakpoints by using the shortcut or use the breakpoints list to the left where I can actually delete them by deleting a line or adding them as I go. It's pretty easy to see where breakpoints are marked. To make things a little bit nicer, you can configure different icons to be set with a breakpoint. So I just set a big red circle that it's easier to understand and see where the breakpoints are. And that will be changed to a green line once the debugger hits the breakpoint. You don't have to, you can change the line obviously and change a set of other icons that I've left uncommented in my configuration if you'd like to use it. That's a pretty neat addition and it helps a lot, which is, by the way, kind of similar to the other IDEs in the market that run their own debuggers. So these are the other set of icons I was discussing. You can set them, reset them, delete them, bring your own. It's pretty customizable and really easy to work with. I'll stop this part here, but you don't stop here. After installing the debugger and playing a little bit around with it on your own, make yourself comfortable in integrating it into your daily workflow as part of building an application. Every other Vim as an IDE setting I have that you may have seen here or want to catch up is in the video right here. And please tell me what you think in the comments. Do you find DAP useful? Do you find it better or comparable to other IDEs? Do you find something that I may have missed or that you can do better or something that you may want to ask? Please leave comments down below and let me know and see you on the next one.